Hello students, today I am going to explain you Unit 4 of Macroeconomics of Class 12 CBSE portion. This chapter is Government Budget and the Economy, Chapter 10. Government is required to do lot of expenditures in the economy because government is responsible for infrastructural, economical and the social development, that is welfare of the public, the people who are residing in the country. So it is important to first chalk out proper plans and policies for which the budget is to be prepared. These policies are related to the receipts of the government and the expenditures, the areas where the expenditure should be done, etc. So we can say budget is a document that contains the detailed information about all the programs and policies of the government. So it is made on all the levels because all the governments work for it, like central, state and local government. Our class 12 portion is restricted to the union budget only, that is budget made by central government. So let us discuss about the budget, that is receipt side as well as expenditure side. When expenditures are planned, we need to first focus what are the actual receipts. Let me tell you, these are the budgets which are prepared. These are the plans. These are not the actual figures, but these are the estimated expenditures of coming fiscal year. Fiscal year means the financial year, which is followed from 1st of April to 31st of March in our country, India. The budget is to be passed in presence of president in the parliament as and on the date approved, but by month of February it is to be passed because from 1st April the new session is started. So this is declared in the parliament by the government, so that the approval can be taken by the president. So there are certain objectives according to which government has to work, and the budgets, that is the plans and policies, are chalked out. Let us discuss these objectives first. First, I have written the meaning, that is meaning of the government budget. Government budget, as I told you, is the annual statement showing item-wise estimates of receipts and payments made during a fiscal year. The objectives of government budget. Government is responsible for infrastructural, economical as well as social welfare of the country. So we should keep all these three points in mind. Then if we will try to understand the objectives, it will be more easy for us. First objective is reallocation of resources. Reallocation of resources is done as per the priorities of the country. It means that if we need to focus on the welfare, then welfare activities are done and accordingly the budget is made. If profit maximization is the motive of the government, because government need to make expenditures further, then that should be the motive. It depends on the economic condition of the country. So, it may have two deviations. First is tax concessions or subsidies. To encourage the investments, tax concessions may be given to such kind of industries which are less in the country or in which more development is required. Moreover, subsidies can be given to such kind of industries which are manufacturing the products which ultimately give improvement to the GDP of the country. It means that the agricultural products, the agriculture is giving 70% of the GDP of our country. It contributes to 70% of the GDP. But if the industries like fertilizer manufacturing industries, the manures manufacturing industries, they will be selling their products to the farmers who are really poor, so the profit margin is less. In this case, if subsidy will be given, it will be an encouragement to the people that so that they can produce such kind of goods which will ultimately give benefit to the country. So these things should be kept in mind. This is an example I have given you. In such a way, the encouragement of investments in particular areas or focus is given to particular areas through such kind of activities. Next is directly producing goods and services. The goods and services which are less profitable in nature, like sanitization, it brings welfare, but the profit motive is not there. Motive is regarding the welfare. There are other such kind of activities which are done in the economy on which government has to pay attention or contribution regarding its generation. So directly producing goods and services which are less profitable is also done by the government, on which expenditure is made and proper budget is required. Next is reducing inequalities in income and wealth. The inequalities can be reduced by imposing more taxes on rich and less taxes on poor, or on no taxes or poor, or we can say providing subsidies to the poor. So in this case, in the country like India, as there are rich people less and poor people more, government is having a slab system of imposing the taxes. Those who are more rich, their income is more. On those people, more taxes are imposed, and the percentage of taxes on as the income reduces, the percentage of tax also reduces. Next is economic stability. Economic stability means, stability here means bringing stability in fluctuations in the prices. The goods which are available in the country, they should be available at proper prices, and there should not be fluctuations in price. There should not be inflationary pressure. Moreover, there should not be deflationary pressure. What is inflationary pressure and what is deflationary pressure? I have explained in my previous video, in which excess demand and excess supply is clearly discussed. So here, bringing stability in fluctuations in prices through taxes and expenditure is done. Inflationary pressure is controlled by reducing the expenditure, and deflationary pressure is controlled by giving taxes, concessions and subsidies. This is clearly explained in the previous video. Kindly go through the video of excess demand and a deficient demand chapter. Then management of public enterprises. There are some natural monopolies that government holds, like railway. Railway department is completely in hand of government. It's a monopoly because it is not allowed to be managed by the private organizations. So for this also proper management is required. The post offices were also example of it, but now we don't give such kind of examples because nowadays all the things are privatized. Natural monopoly is for the railway department only, for which government has to plan, government has to make the budget. Next is economic growth. Economic growth is related to increasing the GDP. GDP will increase when the output, that is final value of goods and services produced in the country, will be increased. So government has to think about these also. This is also managed by giving tax concessions or imposing more taxes, as the case may be, on various kinds of goods. Next is reducing regional disparities. Reducing regional disparities means, in the economy like India, there is variation and regional disparities in the country. Like one region is highly developed, but there are many regions which are not at all developed, which are under development. So for development of these regions, government may plan to establish such kind of industries where investments are done and the people nearby, they will be able to get the employment. When employment opportunities will be provided, people will be able to earn the income. So this also needs proper investment. For this, subsidies are also given to the public. They can establish such kind of industries in rural areas or underdeveloped areas. So with all these objectives, government plans the budget. Now let us see the components of budget. Components of the budget can be categorized as per the receipts and the payments made by the government, or we can say the expenditure made by the government. So first is the budget receipts. Budget receipt means from all the sources, whatever money is received by the government is called as budget receipt, which can be categorized under the various heads. First is revenue receipt. Revenue receipt is that kind of receipt which neither create any liability nor cause any reduction in asset of the government. It means both the conditions are to be satisfied. First condition is it should not create any liability. It should not create any liability means if the government is receiving any loan from any organization, say IMF or World Bank or general public, that is public debt, it will be a loan which will create a liability. But if government is receiving money in form of say taxes or the fees charged by the government in courts or there are many other sources, so that will not be creating any liability. So these are called as the revenue receipt. Second condition is it should not cause any reduction in asset. If the money is received by selling the securities of public enterprises, then this is also creating a loss in the asset side of the balance sheet. So this should not happen. It means that both the side of the balance sheet, liability side as well as asset side, should not be disturbed, should not be changed. This is called as revenue receipt. Revenue receipts are actually recurring in nature. Revenue receipts are such receipts which are done in normal course of business. So these receipts can be tax revenues and non-tax revenues. First is direct and indirect tax. Tax revenue, it can be categorized under direct taxes and indirect taxes. Direct taxes are imposed on property and income of individuals or organizations, say companies. The actual burden of payment of this tax, that is direct tax, is on the same person on whom the tax is imposed. This is important to note here. I am again repeating, the direct burden of paying the taxes is on the same individual or company on which the tax is imposed by the government. This tax cannot be avoided, otherwise person is penalized. It directly affects the income level or the purchasing power of the person, because the tax is to be paid first, then whatever is left is the disposable income which a person, that is an individual or a company, can spend. Second category of tax is indirect tax. Indirect tax affect the income and property of individual and company through their consumption expenditure. It means that if they want to avoid that tax, it can be easily done by not entering into the transaction. If the purchasing is not done for a particular product, the indirect tax can be avoided. The reason behind this is the tax is imposed on goods and service, and it is collected from, that is payment of burden is on the different person, that is a person who is purchasing it. So this kind of tax can be avoided by not entering into the transaction. It liability of paying and actual burden of tax lie on the different persons. Next category of tax is non-tax revenue. There are various other heads under which government receive the money from the general public, or we can say from the individuals, except then that of the taxes. These are, first is interest. Interest is the amount which government receives in proper percentage from the loans which has been provided by the government, say to the state government, to the local government, or to RBI, or to the other government, say other country's government. When loan is given, then on these loan, when interest is received, it is counted under this head. Second is profits and dividends. Government has shares or contributions, that is, there are many organizations, public enterprises, which are controlled, managed and owned by the government, such as railway department. So profit received for holding the shares or the ownership of the enterprise is under this head. Third is fees and license fees. Fees means actually the amount which is received by the government, administrative departments, for providing various services. Like when we go to courts, we are required to register the cases, then fees is charged. If we go to any such department, say we are going to RTO for getting the license of driving the vehicles, then it is under this head. Then next is license fees. License fees means the fees which is actually paid to the government by the public for getting license. Say we can say the license for motor vehicles, or we can say license for utilization of guns or weapons. So this is under this head. Next is fines and penalties for breaking the laws. The fines and penalties are charged by the government. Next is escheats. Escheats means if a person dies without any legal heir, then the property of that person is claimed by the government under this head. Next is gifts and grants. Government receives gifts and grants from public or from other governments in case of crisis. As this is not recurring in nature, it is under this head. Next is forfeitures. Forfeitures are the penalties imposed by the banks or government departments for not complying any rule and regulation or any promise. Next is special assessment. Because of the expenditure made by government on particular asset, or we can say investment made by the government, suppose construction of road. Because of construction of road in rural areas, the transportation system has been developed, and because of this, the people are able to move here and there easily, and the value of their property has been increased. So this value is increased because of the investment made by the government. So for this, the government charge some special kind of money from the public whose property's value has been increased. This is under this head, the special assessment. Next category is capital receipt. Capital receipts are actually the receipts which either create liability or cause a reduction in assets of the government. It either creates liability, or there is a capital receipt. There is a receipt which is creating liability. The very simple example of this can be loan taken by the government. Then it may cause a reduction in assets of the government. The reduction in asset of the government, the best example is government is selling its shares or securities to general public, then the assets will be reduced. So this is an example of capital receipt. This can be under three categories. First is borrowings. Borrowings or loans can be taken by open market. Open market is actually the public, RBI, Reserve Bank of India, that is Central Bank, foreign governments, World Bank, IMF, or international financial institutions. Next is recovery of loan. If a loan has been provided earlier to to any of the organization and that loan is paid back now, this is also a category of capital receipt. Next is other receipts. Other receipts are the receipts like disinvestment or small savings. Disinvestment means when government sell its securities to reduce its own shares in particular organizations or companies. So in this way, the shares are sold and the money is received. Small savings are like people are saving in post office banks. They are purchasing national savings certificates. So these are government recognized. Through this, government receive the money and give a particular certificate which has a value to the public. So this is also under capital receipt head. Next head is the budget expenditure. Under budget expenditure, there are various heads on which the expenditure is made by the government. This is again categorized into revenue expenditure and capital expenditure. Revenue expenditure is recurring in nature and it is incurred on normal functioning of the government. As it is revenue in nature, it does not affect the balance sheet. That is, it neither creates any asset nor causes reduction in liabilities of the government. Suppose payment of salary to the government departments, people of the employees of the government department. Next is capital expenditure. Capital expenditure creates an asset or causes a reduction in liability of the government. It is non-recurring, an addition to capital stock means the capital is increased and such kind of investment give long run profit. So construction of government hospitals, construction of government schools are the capital expenditures. Now as we have understood, there can be two types of budgets. That is budget receipt and budget expenditure. These are the components of budget. So budgets can be balanced budget, surplus budget or deficit budget. Balanced budget means when receipts are equal to expenditure. Surplus budget means when expenditure is less and receipts are more. Then budget is in surplus. But deficit budget means when expenditure is more than that of the receipts. This is the condition of Indian economy. In our next topic, we will study only the deficit budget. Next heading is measures of government deficit. Measures of government deficit means here we are going to study about the various types of deficits which are under budgetary deficit. Budgetary deficit means excess of total estimated expenditure over total estimated revenue. It means that whatever is the revenue generated by the government and the expenditure made, the expenditure is more than that of the revenue. This is the reason it is called as deficit, because government is going in losses, that is negative side is more. So it can be of three categories. First is revenue deficit. Revenue deficit means revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts. When this figure will be in positive, it will show the total amount by which the revenue is falling short. Next is fiscal deficit. Fiscal deficit means total expenditure minus total receipts excluding borrowings. We are not including borrowings here. Third is primary deficit. Primary deficit means fiscal deficit minus interest payments. Let us understand all these three with its implications. First is revenue deficit. Revenue deficit signifies that government's own revenue is insufficient to meet the expenditures or normal functioning of government departments and provision for various services. Implications of revenue deficit are, first, it indicates that the government is not able to meet its regular and recurring expenditures in the proposed budget. Second, it implies that government is dis-saving, that is, government is using the savings of other sectors to finance its consumption expenditure. Third, it implies that government has to make up this deficit from capital receipt, that is, the borrowings or disinvestments will be done to make over these expenditures, and revenue deficit will lead to increase in liability in form of borrowings or reduces the assets through disinvestment. Fourth, use of capital receipts for meeting the extra consumption expenditure lead to an inflationary situation in the economy. Higher borrowings increase the future burden in terms of loan amount and interest payments. Last, a high revenue deficit gives a warning signal to the government to either curtail its expenditure or increase its revenue. So there should be the measures to reduce revenue deficit. Government should take serious steps to reduce its expenditures and to avoid unproductive or unnecessary expenditures. And on the other side, government should try to increase the revenue, which may be through the taxable sources or through the those sources which are non-tax revenues. Second point is the physical deficit. Physical deficit refers to the excess of total expenditure over total receipts excluding borrowings during the given fiscal year. The implication of fiscal deficit are, first and most important is debt trap. Debt trap means the total borrowing requirement of the government. Borrowing not only involve repayment of principal amount but also require payment of interest. Interest payment increase the revenue expenditure, which leads to revenue deficit. It creates a vicious circle of fiscal deficit and revenue deficit, wherein government take more loans to repay the earlier loans. As more loans are taken to repay the previous loans, it means that the country is in debt trap. Second is inflation. When government borrows from RBI to meet the fiscal deficit, RBI is required to print new currency. This is called as fiscal deficit. It increases the money supply in the economy and creates inflationary pressure. Third is foreign dependence. When government will ask for the loans from rest of the world, it may raises the dependence on other countries. Fourth is it hampers the future growth because country is coming in debt trap. It adversely affects the future growth and development prospects of the country. So sources of fiscal deficit can be either the borrowing or the deficit financing. Deficit financing means printing of new currency, or borrowing means borrowing from the internal or the external sources. Internal sources may be public, commercial banks, RBI. External sources may be foreign governments, international organizations like IMF, etc. Third category of deficit is primary deficit. Primary deficit refers to difference between fiscal deficit of current year and interest payment on the previous borrowings. So the total borrowing requirement of the government includes the interest commitments on accumulated debts. Primary deficit always reflects the extent to which such interest commitments have compelled the government to borrow in current periods. So implication of primary deficit is it indicates how much of the government borrowings are going to meet expenses other than the interest payments. The difference between fiscal deficit and primary deficit shows amount of interest payment on the borrowings made in plus. So a low or zero primary deficit indicates that interest commitments have forced the government to borrow. This is the reason it is called primary deficit is the root cause of fiscal deficit. High interest payments on past borrowings have increased the fiscal deficit to a great extent. With this, we conclude this unit, which is comprised of only this chapter. Thank you.